As the midterms near, the president and former president hit the campaign trail amidst President Biden's dire warnings about the future of our democracy. Here in Indiana, we're electing a new Secretary of State this year. And today, you'll see our interviews with all three candidates, Diego Morales, Destiny Wells, and Jeff Maurer. It's all ahead right now on this week's edition of In Focus. This weekend, so many people around the world are mourning the loss of Queen Elizabeth II, with flags at half-staff in Washington and here at home. We'll have reaction from Indiana officials coming up. Meantime, here at home, we're also pausing this weekend to remember the anniversary of the 9/11 terror attacks 21 years ago. President Biden commemorating the attacks at the Pentagon this weekend. We'll talk about the 9/11 anniversary with our panel. We're also talking about the upcoming midterms as we sit down with the candidates for Secretary of State. This, as President Biden says, our democracy is at risk, while the former president, now under federal investigation, called President Biden a, quote, enemy of the state. This first week after Labor Day, both Biden and Trump were out on the campaign trail.
We're going to choose to build a better America. A better America. Extreme MAGA Republicans don't just threaten our personal rights and our economic security. They embrace political violence.
Enemies of the state. You're all enemies of the state. He's an enemy of the state.
All right, all this as a new CBS News poll this past week shows 72% of Americans think our democracy is under threat. Among the reasons, 86% of voters said they were concerned about the influence of money in politics, 69% concerned about threats of political violence, and 67% concerned about attempts to overturn elections. Numbers like that illustrate why races for Secretary of State are so crucial this year nationwide. And here in Indiana, we will be electing a new Secretary of State in November. This week, you'll see our interviews with all three candidates in the race, starting with Republican Diego Morales, who's been closely scrutinized throughout the campaign. Morales now pulling back on one of his key proposals. You had initially called for early voting days, cutting those in half from 28 to 14. But in a recent interview, you said that the current early voting system is working great and you plan to keep it that way. Why'd you change your mind?
I don't think we ever changed anything then before the convention. As a private sector businessman, you know, I talk about ideas and solutions. Let me be clear, what is working right now, early voting, 28 days is working, that's the way it's going to stay.
But you had proposed 14 initially.
As I said, we are, any election laws that we will pass in the state of Indiana, it will be through the General Assembly. I'm no one person who will be able to do anything. So my job will be working with the General Assembly to pass any election laws.
In a statement after that interview, Indiana Democrats said, quote, voters can't trust you. They said you were singing a different tune. And they also pointed to what they called shady campaign finance issues, referencing your campaign's purchase of a $40,000 card that before you'd won your party's nomination. In the meantime, some polls have shown that this race could be pretty close. One poll had your opponent up 3 points. Are you concerned some Republicans aren't supporting your campaign because of some of these situations and controversies in the news?
I don't think there's any controversy. This is, for a successful campaign, this is standard to, you know, to invest on a vehicle. Like me, I'm a grassroots guy. I put 150,000 miles in my car since the day I announced to convention day. And now we have already put almost 20,000 miles on the new car because I visit all 92 counties of this great state of Indiana. I'm a grassroots guy, and that's what I like to do.
You dispute the notion that that's any kind of campaign finance issue at all?
A successful campaign is a standard for any successful standard campaign to do this.
President Biden gave a speech last week saying democracy was at stake in the upcoming elections. He said Donald Trump and MAGA Republicans, in his words, represented extremism that he said threatens the republic. He said democracy can't survive when one side believes they win or they were cheated. What was your reaction to that speech?
You know, my reaction is that my job is to encourage every single Hoosier to get out there and vote. In fact, I'm the only minority running in the state of Indiana, and I'm the one who's encouraging minorities to get involved, to be part of the process. you know, President Biden is the president. He's in the White House. He can do whatever he wants to do. My focus is in Indiana, and my focus is to encourage every single Hoosier to get out and vote.
This concern about the strength of our democracy is something that voters have been expressing some concerns about in recent polling. Your opponent has talked about this recently as well, and here's what she had to say. She said, it's very impersonal to me that we uphold democracy. There's a direct threat against it this year, she said, referring to you. She called you an election denier and said she didn't think you would bat an eye in subverting democracy if called upon. What's your response to her remarks there?
Number two, I talk about the issues. You know, I don't talk about other things. Unfortunately, people who they don't talk about the issues, policies, or they don't have ideas, they have to talk about this. I've been clear to say that President Biden is the legitimate president. He's in the White House. I choose to focus on election integrity. How can we make sure help our business owners, our auto dealers division, and the securities
you
division?
You had, though, in an op-ed, questioned the results of the election earlier this year, correct?
What I said is that President Biden is in the White House, although I did not vote for him. I'm a lifelong Republican, and he's doing a horrible job.
Your opponent, she's called you an election denier because of some of your previous statements. You've said you've moved on, but it continues to be a relevant question for this office in particular. So I wanted to ask the question this way, since you worked for Mike Pence in the past. In your view, did Mike Pence do the right thing on January 6th?
He did follow the U.S. Constitution.
And that's the right thing in your view? He did the right thing?
Absolutely. Because we follow the U.S. Constitution. You and I and the Vice President, we all should follow the U.S. Constitution.
Your opponents are both appearing together at various debates around the state. You haven't joined them yet. Why not?
I'm a grassroots guy. I visit with the newbie heckle that we bought. I'm a grassroots person. I'm the only candidate who has crisscrossed all 92 counties multiple times, meeting with voters one-on-one. That's been my campaign since day one, and that's exactly what I'm going to continue to do.
You don't think it's important to meet with the candidates face-to-face, have voters have that chance to look at all three of you?
They know who they're going to vote for. I'm trying to convince voters who will vote for me. I don't think my opponents, they will vote for me. I will not vote for them. So what do I need to?
What else would you want voters to know before they go to the polls this November about your campaign and what kind of office you'd want to run as Secretary?
My number one goal is to increase voter confidence, to make sure to have the opportunity to every single Hoosier voters to get out there and vote and be part of the process, especially minorities. I'm a minority. I'm the only minority in the state of Indiana who's running for this office. Tell me if that's not progress. Number two, I want to make sure that to help our small business owners, our auto dealers, and as well as under the securities division of the office to focus on financial literacy, it is time to bring back, you know, the basics. But most importantly, I want to tell others, to my fellow Hispanics and immigrants here in Indiana, regardless of where they live, I am proof that the American dream is still alive and well. I came here with nothing, with no money, not knowing a word of English. I believe that I'm living the American dream.
All right, more of that interview on our website. I also spoke recently with Democratic candidate Destiny Wells. Your opponent in this race, Diego Morales, the Republican vying to be Secretary of State, he's worked in this office before. He said he wants to make several reforms to the office. What do you make of his platform and some of the things he's called for?
Right. So he was fired from the office a couple of times as a low-level employee. And coming in and saying you want to make reforms, you have to broker those relationships within the office before you can even do that. It's not the position of a legislator who can implement laws. You have to be able to work across the aisle and with Republicans who have set these laws over the years.
How would you have managed the 2020 election differently if you'd been in office?
Well, our polls show that Hoosiers overwhelmingly believe that Indiana elections are fair, safe, and secure. So when it came to Connie Lawson implementing more expansive mail-in voting during 2020, I thought that was a great start. Other states do that all the time. Right now, there are 11 exceptions that you can cast an absentee ballot by mail. My opponent wants to limit it to 4. And so, for example, 65 and older, they can use mail-in absentee voting. I want to maintain that. I want to maintain at least the 11 standards that we have, and then go from there and make reasonable suggestions to the legislature in expanding absentee voting.
And obviously, a lot of that would fall upon the legislature. This is a legislature that could potentially go the other direction, too, in terms of writing laws relating to our elections and what the secretaries of state can do in the state of Indiana. If elected, do you anticipate a lot of discord there with the legislature over what election law should look like in the state of Indiana?
And unfortunately, over the summer, we've seen that Republican supermajority legislature really not act in accordance with the will of Hoosiers. For example, SB 1, you know, if the majority of Hoosiers want something and the legislature is not listening, why is that? So we need to look very deep as to why we have these problems. Part of that is gerrymandering. You know, so as Secretary of State, we need to be looking from to 2031 when we have redistricting and be advocating on behalf of Hoosiers so that Hoosiers' voices are actually heard.
Polls have shown this could be a close race, but obviously this does tend to be a red state politically. How challenging will it be just in terms of fundraising, getting all the resources required to win a race like this?
Well, I've already outraised my opponent 6-1 last quarter. I outraised him for the entire year. We launched in January. We had a little shorter runway because I came off of active duty with the military. But by all means, I mean, we're doing fantastic when it comes to fundraising and running a competitive race.
What else is it going to take between now and Election Day to win this race and become the first Democrat to win a statewide office since 2012?
Well, unfortunately, we need to let Hoosiers know who my opponent is and the threat there and how he wants to roll back voting. You know, we need to talk about things, unfortunately, that he spent $44,000 of campaign cash on a car. Why can you do that? Well, Indiana is one of the last in the country when it comes to campaign finance. So those are things that we need to start informing Hoosiers about. We have 76 days left, so it is kind of pedal to the metal at this point.
All right, again, you can find the full interview online. Finally, part of my chat this week with Libertarian candidate Jeff Maurer.
Hoosiers are just sick and tired of being sick and tired. We're exhausted with the status quo. We're exhausted with hyper-partisan, angry politics. And we just want government to work for us. And I'm running for receipts and audits. Two common sense solutions any Hoosier can get behind and fix the problem of our elections. A good election is one where the losers accept the results, not because they like the outcome, but because they trust the process. We need to get back to that.
The Democratic opponent in this race is called the Republican opponent, an election denier. You mentioned accepting the results of the election. Do you have similar concerns about some things he has said about the 2020 election?
I'm focused on the results of the elections. So I myself accept the results of the 2020 election. The problem is that we can't understand what really happened because there's no way to audit it. And so I'm focused on giving us the tools to audit an election and not just prove that there was, if there was fraud, but prove that there was no fraud.
What would you want to bring from a libertarian perspective into the Secretary of State's office?
From a libertarian perspective, we want accountability, transparency, and really responsiveness. And so what we see from politicians today, many of whom will be on the ballot in November, they are not responding. They're not answering. They're not appearing. They're not taking phone calls. And that's the frustration that Hoosiers have.
Coming up next on this week's edition of In Focus, Indiana's new abortion ban goes into effect this coming week. We'll talk with our panel about the practical and political implications. And the world mourning the loss of Queen Elizabeth II. We'll have reaction from Indiana officials coming up.